Hello, and welcome to the Planning Your Research module of the Research Data Training Series. I am Paul Byrne, Research Data Services Librarian at Syracuse University Libraries. What we will cover in this module are the basics of planning your research, planning your data analysis, planning your data, planning your data collection, and planning your documentation. First, a note about planning in general. Contrary to popular belief, plan is not a four-letter word. Planning your research may seem tedious, but it will save you much time and many headaches later on. Not planning is like getting in your car to go somewhere you have never been before and not having any directions or a map. You may eventually get there, but it will not be a pleasant trip and will certainly take much longer than it should. One of the most common questions I get is, I have all my data, now what do I do? Unfortunately, sometimes the answer is not what you said you were going to do in your proposal, because you either did not collect the correct data or you did not collect it properly. Planning your research will cut down on unpleasant surprises and help you to remember what the end result should be. Just a quick note about project management. If your project will require several people to work with you, or you will need to collect data from different places at different times, then you really should become familiar with the practice of project management. There are many free online courses as well as software available. Please look at the supplementary materials on our webpage for more information. So how should you go about planning your research? The most common advice I give to people starting the research process is, do it backwards. Specifically, ask yourself, what do I want to be able to say in the end? Write your conclusion as though everything turned out the way you wanted. So, for example, you may want to be able to say, on average, men are taller than women. What does this conclusion tell you about what type of analysis you will need to do to support it? Well, I want to know the difference in the averages of two groups. This is a t-test. Then, what kind of data will you need to perform that type of analysis? To perform a t-test, I need one continuous variable and one nominal variable. The continuous variable will be height, and the nominal variable will be gender. Then, you need to determine how will you get the data you need. There are several options for this. A survey where the subject tells you their gender and height. This is relatively easy to administer, but people could lie or simply not know how tall they are. Or you could have subjects come to your office and you measure them yourself. You will get accurate measurements, but perhaps not many people will want to come to your office. Or you may even be able to get them from medical records. The point is, how will your method of collecting the data affect the quantity and quality of? So let's plan the data analysis. Of course, first you will need to determine what analyses you need to perform. Be sure that you know what the analysis actually does, what its assumptions are, and that you can interpret the results, as well as explain and defend them. Be sure that whatever software you will be using can actually do this kind of analysis. Very importantly, be sure you know how to do the analysis in whatever software you will use. Not every package implements a particular analysis in the same way. It may even be worthwhile looking at other software packages that may do this kind of analysis in a simpler fashion. Next, determine what tables, charts, and other graphics you will need to create to describe your data and present your results. You should look at previously published research, to see what you will need to do. Remember, most software does not produce publication-ready charts and tables, so you will need to export them to a word processor and edit them further. Once you have all your data and it has been cleaned, see the module on cleaning your data, run all of your descriptive statistics, mean, standard deviation, skewness, kurtosis for continuous variables, frequencies and crosstabs for categorical and nominal variables, and any other appropriate information. It is important to know your data. You cannot properly analyze your data if you do not know what you have. Keeping with our previous example, perhaps you also collected your subject's race and age, thinking these may interact with gender. By running crosstabs on race and gender, you might find that you do not have enough subjects in a particular group to run a proper analysis. You need to know this before you do the analysis so you do not misinterpret the results. Now that you know what analyses you will do, you need to determine what data you will need to conduct those analyses. To begin, create a list of all the variables you think you will need. If you are not sure if you will need a particular variable, include it. You can always drop it later on. When listing your variables, include the variable name, a description of what the variable is measuring, the measurement level, namely continuous, categorical, nominal, etc., possible values the variable may have, including all possible values for nominal and categorical variables, and ranges for continuous variables. Be sure to include codes for missing data. See the module on cleaning your data for more about missing data. Also include the source of the information, a variable you will collect via survey, one you will get from secondary data, etc. And whether it is a raw or computed variable. A computed variable is one that is created using other variables in your data. There is a sample Excel spreadsheet in the supplementary materials on our webpage to help you with this process. To help make sure you will include all variables you'll need, list them in this order. First, list all the variables you will need to test your hypotheses. Next, list any variables that you will create based on the variables you will collect. List other descriptive variables you will need. And don't forget any identification variables. If you will be using secondary data along with your own, make sure that your ID variables are created and formatted like those in the secondary data so records can be matched. Remember, you should collect the components of computed variables rather than the computed variable itself. For example, if you need BMI, body mass index, collect height in one variable and weight in another variable. Then use those two to compute BMI. Next, you will need to determine how you will collect your data. Developing more than one way, or at least different versions of the same method, will help you to look at the benefits and drawbacks of each. Regardless of what method you use, you should always ask yourself, how will this method of data collection affect the quantity and quality of the data you gather? What tools, special equipment, software, personnel, or permission will you need? It may seem obvious, but be sure that you can get these materials and know how to use them. Changes in policies, personnel, versions, etc. can all impact the availability and usability of any materials. If the tools you use cannot do the analysis you plan, then you'll need to export the data to another package. Make sure you can do this before you collect any data. Next, determine how long it will take to collect the data. Make sure you keep in mind any deadlines for applications, use of special tools, etc. Also, be sure to include training time for yourself and others who might be involved in your project. Pilot tests can be immensely helpful in finding any potential problems with your study. It would be best to give it to potential subjects, but even if you just give it to a few of your friends, you will likely find things that could be improved. And no matter how long you determine it will take to collect your data, it will always take longer. If you will be using secondary data, make sure you can indeed access it and use it the way you intend to. Always read and follow the terms of use. If it is restricted data, be sure that you can actually get your hands on it and for how long, as well as what it takes to get the data. Many restricted data sets require proposals and/or signatures from the IRB or other entities in the university. This process can take a long time and may not always result in you getting the data. If you're required to share your data, either by the funding agency, journal, or whoever, you need to find out what restrictions there may be on sharing the secondary data as well. If you are not allowed to share the secondary data, be sure to include in your documentation instructions on how others can obtain the data and match it with any other data you might provide. If you're only using part of a larger data set, be sure to document how you subsetted it. This means you need to save your well-commented programs and include a full description of the query or methods you used to extract the data. If you will be using data from more than one source, make sure you will have a way of linking the various files. Let's move on to planning your documentation. Good documentation will help you keep track of your project. Knowing what you did, how you did it, and why you did it will help keep moving you along and know where you are in the process. It will also help remind you of what you did should you need to revise it later on. Don't wait until the project is over to start documenting it. By that time, you may very well have forgotten important information. Documenting your project can be a very time-consuming endeavor if you don't keep up with it. Hopefully, it will become second nature. If you are required to share your data, then the documentation will be crucial to others who wish to use your data. Also, you should determine what requirements your funding agency or data repository might have regarding documentation. Follow their requirements from the start. Good documentation includes these items. Please see the module on documenting your research for more details. So, in conclusion, there are many details to be worked out before you start your project. The more you can identify before you start, the easier your life will be. Since every project is different, we can only do a broad overview here. You will discover other details as you move along. Planning for all details may be time-consuming, but it will save you even more time later on, and perhaps even avoid catastrophe. Thank you for viewing this module on planning your research. If you have any questions or comments, please let us know. Our contact information can be found on the webpage. Now, on to the next module, documenting your research.